Russian state and the Trump campaign.
Mr. Mueller needs to be able to complete his investigation without interference.
This is New Day with Allison Camerata and John Berman.
Good morning, everyone. Welcome to your New Day. We are here in Washington this morning where the nation will bid farewell to our 41st president, George Herbert Walker Bush. He will make his final journey to Washington today. He will lie in state at the U.S. Capitol Rotunda for the public to pay respects until Wednesday morning. Traveling with the president, his faithful service dog, Sully. You can see him here in this photo. He is a yellow lab who has been with the president since the passing of Barbara Bush last spring. Such a nice picture there. President Bush will be flown here on the presidential plane that we all know as Air Force One when the current president is on board. This flight will be dubbed Special Mission 41.
President Trump will attend the state funeral Wednesday at the National Cathedral, and that's significant. You may remember President Trump did not attend the service for Barbara Bush or the one for John McCain. But Bush 41 made it clear he wanted President Trump to be there. It will be an important and rare show of unity. Meanwhile, back to the business of Washington. The possibility of a government shutdown over border wall funding will likely be put off for a couple of weeks, but the Russia investigation seems to continue apace. Michael Cohen's lawyers are asking a judge for leniency and in the process revealing new information. And the president's friend and advisor, Roger Stone, insists that he had no contacts with the head of WikiLeaks, Julian Assange. We begin our coverage with CNN's Kayleigh Hartung. She is live in Ellington Field in Texas with more. Good morning, Kayleigh.
Good morning, Allison. Special Mission 41, the late former president's final flights aboard the 747, will begin this morning. On board to escort the president's remains from Houston to Washington, we're told will be members of the Bush family, including George W. Bush, close friends, members of his staff, including his Secretary of State, James Baker, and also his service dog, Sully. You mentioned that beautiful photo posted last night of the dog laying in front of his casket with the caption, "Mission complete." That dog's next mission to service veterans at Walter Reed. There will be a departure ceremony here at Ellington Air Base this morning. And then upon their arrival at Joint Base Andrews, another ceremony to welcome them. Once they get to the Capitol, there will be a ceremony there, and members of congressional leadership will host it. We're told Vice President Pence among those who will speak there. And the president will lie in state in the Capitol's rotunda until Wednesday morning, allowing the public a chance to pay their respects there. Following that, a service at Washington's National Cathedral, President Trump among those who will be in attendance. And then the president's remains will be returned here to Houston. There will be a second memorial service on Thursday morning at St. Martin's Episcopal Church, the same church that Barbara Bush was celebrated in more than 7 months ago. The president's remains will then be taken by train to his final resting place, that in College Station, Texas, at Texas A&M University, the home of his presidential library. We've learned that in the president's final hours, he was asked if he wanted to go to the hospital. He said no. He was ready to go be with Barbara and Robin, and that is where he will be laid to rest, right alongside them. John and Allison.
Oh, my gosh, that's so poignant. Kayleigh, thank you very much for that report from Texas. Joining us now to talk about all of this, we have CNN political analyst David Gregory, CNN White House correspondent Abby Phillip, CNN political commentator and host of CNN Smirkanish, Michael Smirkanish, and Frank Says No, former CNN Washington bureau chief and now director of George Washington University's School of Media and Public Affairs. Great to have all of you here this morning on this very, the beginning of this very special week here in Washington. Michael Smirkanish, we found a photo of Boy Wonder, Michael Smirkanish. You can tell us the history of this moment of when you met President Bush and what was happening here.
That photograph was actually taken when I was an intern in his advance office. And on the last day of the internship, I was afforded a 3-minute meeting for a photograph. Now, I have to say, fast forward a decade, when I was 29, I was appointed by his presidential administration from the Department of Housing and Urban Development to run all public housing in 5 states and Washington, D.C. And I think, in a way, it says something about the Bush administration and this president and the way that he regarded dues paying. Allison, when I think about him, I think about the first time that I met him in 1980, running for president, when the slogan was, "A president we won't have to train," in view of the fact that he had already been UN ambassador, envoy to China, head of the CIA, member of Congress, business success. I mean, in sharp contrast, I have to say, to today, the way in which people can be become media sensations and think they can run for office. This was a guy who believed you had to log the hours.
And of course, the president, he wouldn't have to train. He was talking about Ronald Reagan, who at that point had been a former two-term governor of California. You know, no political slouch himself. It was a remarkable thing to say in 1980, a really fascinating campaign. Frank Sesno, you covered former President Bush in so many different ways for so long. And we note he is the last president of the greatest generation, the final member of the World War II generation who will be in the White House.
And he brought all of that with him everywhere he went, including in some of his contradictions, you know. But he believed in service. He had done it himself. He believed in sacrifice. He had done it himself. He believed in personal responsibility. His whole 1,000 points of light was, we don't need the government to do all this stuff. Although he believed in government, too, he really believed in volunteerism. But he, you know, he could play politics. I was on the floor of the convention when he said, read by lips, no new taxes. And we thought that was kind of an interesting comment. It came back to haunt him. But I think that understanding George Herbert Walker Bush is what Michael said a moment ago and what you were getting at here. He believed in paying dues. He believed in public service. He believed in what could be done together, flaws and all.
I mean, what's interesting, David, is that the no new taxes came back to haunt him because he decided it was best for the country to cut down on the deficit and to raise taxes. To go back on a campaign promise, he decided at great political peril to himself to do that for the country. That also seems to be a bygone time.
Because he believed in the backroom deal, he believed in working Washington in a way that Washington no longer works, personal relationships. He didn't have a ton of legislative accomplishments because he did have to deal with the Democratic Congress. But even in foreign affairs, dealing with the Chinese in a quieter way after Tiananmen Square got him a lot of criticism as well. You learn a lot about President Bush 41 by understanding President Bush 43. And the no new taxes pledge is so important because he ended up having to run in 92 as, who do you want, the guy who raised taxes once and felt bad about it, or the guy who's done it 120 times and doesn't have any problem with it? He allowed himself to get away from his Republican base, which is something that George W. Bush would never do. And H.W. Bush made compromises of his own with his own pragmatism along the way. He had campaigned in earlier efforts where he'd lost, running too far to the right and then promising not to do that again. So, and of course, how he got elected in 88 with some bare-knuckle tactics that he would kind of apologize for and say, you're not going to see that guy again. So he was this pragmatist. He wore the office very well, and he comes from a time of more genteel politics that is gone.
I have to say, it's remarkable. Frank brought up 1,000 points of light. One of the recent connections between the current president and Bush 41 was that President Trump has mocked the 1,000 points of light during campaign rallies. He's been going up and saying, 1,000 points of light, what's that? I prefer, you know, America first.
And it's more than just the fact that he thinks it's not that great of a slogan. I think the idea of 1,000 points of light is not necessary. It doesn't align with President Trump's vision for what leadership is supposed to engender in people. I think he views strength as being the predominant thing that he needs to embody as president of the United States. And I think President George H.W. Bush believed that the moral leadership of the office was as important as that. And so that's why the 1,000 points of light thing, the fact that President Trump chose that to underscore why he didn't understand that era in American history tells us so much. It also tells us a lot that the White House basically went back on that in their statement over the weekend. They included 1,000 points of light as being the epitome of what George H.W. Bush was all about. I think President Trump is having a moment this weekend. I think his staff thinks so, too. They're very happy with how he's dealt with this situation, because despite the criticism, he has been genuine in his praise of President Bush. And I think allowing President Trump to kind of grow in this particular respect is probably worth doing.
Michael Smirkanish, he talked, I mean, as Abby was just saying, respecting the office of president was very important to President Bush. I have my own old photo with President Bush, and I see your old photo and raise you this one. This was, I think, August of 1999. I'm there on a beautiful day in Kennebunkport with my camera crew, and we were interviewing him, and he talked about the Clinton scandal, the impeachment scandal, but very gently, and why he felt it was just so important to preserve the respect for the office. So listen to this moment that plays into now.
But I have said publicly that it concerns me when the office of the presidency has not shown proper respect, the office itself. It's a special symbol around the world, not just the physical Oval Office, but what the presidency means. And so I am afraid that the presidency itself has been tarred by certain events. And I think whoever is elected, Republican or Democrat, will have the obligation to lift that office to heights that are beyond challenge in terms of integrity and honor.
So interesting how careful he was being there. I mean, he didn't want to sort of besmirch the office. He could have. His son was running for president at that time, Michael.
And that remarkable op-ed that I know you're familiar with, Allison, in the Washington Post today, where President Clinton reflects on the value he placed on the friendship that he established with George Bush and the letter that was left behind by President Bush for Bill Clinton, which is really a remarkable document. Speaking of service and honoring the country as well as the office, one thing if I can add, I've been going back since learning of his passing and reading portions of All the Best, which is his very unconventional memoir where he assembled. He was a man of letters. He wrote letters. He saved letters. And instead of embellishing, or as he would say, bragging on himself, he went back and chronologically assembled the letters that defined his life, written in real time. And boy, are they a remarkable study as to the life that he led.
But Allison, you know, that soundbite, if I may, what's interesting about hearing former President Bush express that, John and I remember when President George W. Bush, Governor Bush, campaigned, his closing line at all his rallies would be, "I will," which they used to joke about quite a lot, but also the disruption. Pat Buchanan challenging him in 1992, Ross Perot representing the breakdown of the Reagan Revolution, and then, of course, the upstart candidate in Bill Clinton as the representative of the New South, the New Democratic Party. That was all happening, not to mention what was happening in the world and the disintegration of the Soviet Union and a new world order that it was at the dawn of. So all of that coming together in his time.
I have to say, you talked about dynasty there. The first time I met George H.W. Bush, and there is no picture, is when I was a freshman at Andover.
Prove it.
At Phillips Academy. He came and visited Andover when he was vice president and then came back 2 years later as president. Can you imagine a politician today going to his prep school twice these days? No. I mean,
You went to Andover as a student?
I went to Andover as a student.
I didn't realize.
My point is, imagine a politician, the political liability of latching onto your prep school today.
It's a brand of his loyalty. You know, loyalty was a very important part of George Herbert Walker Bush. Loyalty to family, loyalty to friends, loyalty to institutions, loyalty to America. And I think that's what you saw, and that was genuine. And he felt, and he expressed it in that soundbite when he was talking to you, he felt the weight of the office on his shoulders. Yeah. He expressed that frequently.
Can I just ask, though, again, because you were there, we talk about him, and we sometimes forget, this guy knew politics. It wasn't that he couldn't play the game. I mean, 1988 was the, in some ways, the archetypical
campaign. He knew him, but he didn't love him.
Well,
didn't love campaign.
But what people say, critics say, is he hired people to come do it for him.
He did that.
Roger Ailes.
He did that.
Among others in 1988.
That. Yeah. And Manafort and others. I mean, he dealt with people who were out there who did the dirty work. But the difference between then and now is he says, you do it. I don't really
look at how he handled Nixon too, right? He's head of the RNC where he's defending him and he talked about I got two stacks of mail, those saying, why aren't you closer? Why aren't you going farther away? And ultimately had to pull away from that. So he knew how to deal with the politics of the day and how to stay relevant through all of that, even though he definitely was squeamish about it. And again, his son learned all of those lessons and learned how not to.
Though both roles being played at the same time, both the politician, which all of these people are, they're all politicians in some way, doing a lot of dirty work in their campaigns, but in the office of the president, understanding what the imperative, the fact that this week we have an opportunity to see what the transition of leadership means in this country, which is that they all get to be in a room after they've left office, and we honor them for their service, is extremely important. It's important that President Trump is going to be a part of that, because for so long he has tried to be apart from that group. I think that this could be one of those rare times when he comes back into the fold. And for this country, that's important.
It's a moment that only happens in America. My boss was mocking me for noting you don't see former kings going to current kings' funerals because they're all dead. But that's the point. That's the point. We have former presidents here, which is what you have in a democracy. There's a moment, a poignant moment from last night at the Kennedy Center Honors, attended by David Gregory, because he's fabulous. But President George H.W. Bush was honored there. You can see the standing ovation. David, you were there?
Yeah, so, you know, Gloria Estefan, who was the host, told such a personal story how she was playing, I think, at George Mason, and they invited her family over, and President Bush spent 45 minutes talking to her son about education and about the in and outs of the presidency. The next day, she had that terrible accident, mm-hmm. and he checked with her immediately afterward and checked in with her over the years. Again, this famous note writer and correspondent with people was so caring and kept in touch with her, and it was just one of a couple of tributes of people who had talked about their relationship, and a lot of people in the audience, too, or longtime supporters politically of the Bushes, talked about him and remembered him.
That's really nice. The art of note writing. That is really a beautiful thing that I hope has not gone away. And by the way,
it has.
Well, guess what? I mean, Donald Trump, President Trump also writes handwritten notes. Or he did. I've received one.
He does.
He did. I hope that Twitter has not.
Notes, because Allison's right, he does write them to people. He writes them on pictures, he writes them on things that they've written that he likes. He sends people notes, and it's not just the tweets, but we rarely get to see that private side of him.
Do you have time for a quick story?
Yes.
So one of the things that the Bushes did, and it was totally genuine, was they invited the White House press corps over to their home, Kennebunkport, in the summertime for a family gathering. So we went. I had two little boys at the time, a two-year-old and a five-year-old. And there are these great pictures with President Bush engaging one and then engaging the other. And when the pictures came, I said, is there any way the president would sign these to the boys? And they said, of course. And so in they went. About a few weeks later, I got the pictures back with one problem. To Matthew was on the picture to Chris, and to Chris was on the picture. What do I do with this? It's President of the United States. Do I ask him to re-sign these pictures? So I just did casually mention something to someone in the lower press office. And they said, absolutely, the president will want to have you have the right pictures for your boys. They went back in, they printed new pictures, he signed them, lovely signatures, and my boys have them today.
That's beautiful.
We got to visit Kennebunkport only for a couple of days if W was there.
He only went.
Couldn't you just spend a week up here? And he would say, you white wine swillers would love them.
He knew you well, but David Gregory.
But they still went head to head with us, you know. I mean, they didn't co-opt us, we didn't get co-opted, they understood the relationship, didn't love it. Didn't love it. Wouldn't be prudent. There it was.
Guys, we only have 3 hours. Wrap it up. Hard wrap. Thank you all very much for all the remembrances. So what was working with President Bush like if you were on the other side of the political aisle? Well, lie in state at the U.S. Capitol until Wednesday when his state funeral will take place. Joining us now to talk about all of this, we have former Democratic Senator George Mitchell of Maine. He was Senate Majority Leader during the Bush presidency. Senator Mitchell, great to have you here, and we do want to hear your remembrances, particularly during your time as Majority Leader from a different party than President Bush. What was that dynamic like?
Well, we had a good relationship from the beginning. We had a common bond of love of Maine. I was born and raised there. President Bush's family home is there, of course, and he loved it, and his family are esteemed members of our community in Maine. In the first 2 years, we had a great deal of bipartisan cooperation. I in the Senate with Senator Bob Dole, and the both of us with the president himself. In the last 2 years, as we got closer to the next presidential election, it got more difficult. But in that first term, we enacted a lot of major legislation, and the one I give President Bush great credit for was the Clean Air Act, a major achievement, which if I have a moment I'd like to describe. I'd been a part of a bipartisan group of senators who for nearly a decade had pushed for action on clean air, but we made no progress. President Reagan was adamantly opposed, as were many major industries, and we didn't get anywhere. Then President Bush was elected, took office, and within weeks he made a major speech saying that he favored clean air legislation, which dramatically shifted the question from will there be a clean air bill ever to what will be in the bill that the president proposes. And it's clear to me that there would not have been clean air legislation but for his courageous decision. We then had a tough two-year negotiation, which produced a good bill that stands to this day as a testament to public health protection through bipartisan action.
And how do you think President Bush felt about the rollbacks of regulation and the environmental changes that are happening now?
Well, I don't know. I'd not discussed it with him, but I think he must have been disheartened by some of the dramatic changes that have been made that have adversely affected the public health of Americans. But that will be a tale for others to tell.
In those 2 years that you had bipartisan cooperation, why was that possible then and it doesn't seem possible now?
Well, the second question would take a lot longer than we have to describe the increase in hyperpartisanship in our politics, the dramatic flood of money into it, the increasing use of intense partisanship in the drawing of congressional district lines, gerrymandering. But it was possible at the time in part because of the concept that President Bush had of the presidency and politics. He was a practical person. He conducted a very tough campaign to be elected, but he was an honorable man. He believed in country. He, I think, wanted to get things done. I think his concern about the environment was genuine. It was also spurred in part by his friendship with the Canadian Prime Minister, and Canada was very much concerned about the adverse effects of so-called acid rain on their eastern waters. So it was a combination of factors, and we, of course, wanted action. It just wasn't clean air. We enacted the Americans with Disabilities Act, major legislation. Bob Dole, a Republican, Tom Harkin, a Democrat, were the leaders of that. The president signed it into law. And after a very tough battle over taxes and spending, we enacted a very strong budget act in 1990, which took steps toward a budget neutral, a neutral budget, no deficit that took place years later after Clinton's plan followed on it. That was a very tough issue for the president because, of course, he'd made a pledge during the campaign not to raise taxes. And in that budget, there were some taxes that caused him some political pain. But it was the right thing to do for the country.
Yes, we've talked about how rare that seems now to do something that's right for the country, even at your own political peril. While we have you, we do want to take this opportunity to ask you about some current events. And we also have, I think, some video right now, a live shot of the plane, Air Force One, that is getting ready to bring there. The sun is coming up in Texas. It's a beautiful shot as the plane gets ready to bring President Bush's casket here to Washington. So what are your thoughts on what we've just seen at the G20 with President Trump and President Xi of China? Do you think that President Trump's gambit on tariffs, on imposing tariffs and on a trade war threat has ended up working in some way to get President Xi's attention and bring him to the table to negotiate?
Well, I think that the pause for further negotiations is a good thing, and I hope that they will reach agreement within the 90-day time frame or as soon thereafter as possible. I think President Trump is right to be concerned about China's illegal trade practices. Every American president in my lifetime in recent years has had the same position and pushed hard for changes within China. Where I disagree is the method that he is using, that is general tariffs on a variety of goods. I would have preferred more targeted action directed toward those sectors of the Chinese economy in which they are engaging in illegal technology. For example, they impose restrictions on our financial institutions. We should impose counterpart restrictions. We should direct the adverse actions directly toward those segments of their economy that benefit from their illegal actions. I think general tariffs have the effect, of course, imposing the ultimate costs on American consumers and invite the kind of retaliation that's occurred. But I think the concern is a genuine one, and I hope very much that they will be able to work out a way to end what is being described as a trade war and reach agreements that will reduce tariffs and enable more free and open trade between the two countries and others.
Senator George Mitchell, thank you very much for your remembrances of President Bush and your perspective on all of this.
Thank you.
John.
Correspondent Christine Romans joins us now with more. Romans.
Hi there, John. I'm calling it a pause in the trade war, hammered out at that extraordinary meeting. On one side of the table, a president for life. On the other, a man who became president by promising to get tough on China, surrounded by their advisors. The headline, the U.S. to hold off on raising those tariffs on $200 billion worth of Chinese goods from 10% to 25% on January 1st. In exchange, China said it is willing to purchase a very substantial amount of agriculture, energy, and other goods from the U.S. to help reduce the trade imbalance. Now, the two countries now have 90 days to untangle what are decades of American complaints. The Americans want China to stop forced technology transfer, intellectual property theft, non-tariff barriers, and rampant cyber espionage. In a tweet late Sunday night, the president claimed success on auto tariffs, but didn't specify exactly when that change would happen or what the new tariff level would be. The president also declared to reporters on the way home he'd made a, quote, incredible deal with China to open up its economy and end tariffs. And China has not publicly gone that far. Bottom line, they are talking. Tariffs are still on, but not rising, Allison.
Okay, Christine, thank you very much for explaining all of that to us. Meanwhile, we do have some breaking news because protesters on the streets of Paris again this hour. Police have arrested hundreds over the weekend and dozens.
Brooklyn's John Avalon has your reality check, sir.
That's right, guys. Voter fraud. You know, it's one of President Trump's favorite bogeymen. He called it out before the midterm elections, launched a commission to find it, and repeatedly blamed it without evidence for losing the 2016 popular vote. But voter fraud is vanishingly rare in the United States, as study after study has shown. Voter suppression, far bigger problem. Which is why it's big news that voter fraud is being credibly alleged in one North Carolina congressional race. And wait for it, fingers are pointing at the Republican campaign. Republicans have held North Carolina's 9th district since 1963. But this year it saw not just a close primary, but also a close general election. First incumbent Congressman Robert Pittenger narrowly lost the primary to a pastor named Mark Harris, who gained some national attention for statements like wives should submit to their husbands and his belief that the earth is less than 10,000 years old. Now, after the general election, it looked like Harris eked out a 905-vote win over Democrat and former Marine Dan McCready at around a quarter of a million cast. But late last week, the North Carolina Board of Elections voted across party lines to postpone certification of Harris as the winner. Something's rotten in the North Carolina 9th, specifically the rural counties of Bladen and Robeson. Now, both had much higher than average requests for absentee ballots. Nothing sinister there. But a whopping 40% of absentee ballots requested by African Americans were never returned, according to the Rally News and Observer. That's compared with just 17% of white voters' ballots. Now, a local political blogger named Michael Blitzer analyzed the absentee ballot returns in impressive detail. And he found that Harris won more than 61% of absentee votes in Bladen County, but with just 19% of those ballots being from registered Republicans. Blitzer determined that, quote, Harris would have also received almost all the registered unaffiliated voters and some Democrat registered voters to make it to 62% of the vote. So this is perhaps possible, but extremely unlikely. So was Harris's performance in the primary, where he claimed 96% of absentee ballots in Bladen. In addition, so far, 6 official complaints have been filed, including at least 2 alleging that their ballots were collected unsealed by a stranger, which is not just frowned upon, but illegal. All this is shady and definitely deserving of further investigation. Now, the vote for the Republican has so many irregularities that there could end up being a new election, which is possibly why we haven't heard boo about it from the president yet. But he might want to consult his own speech from July 19, 2017, when he said this.
This is not a Democrat or a Republican issue. It's an American issue. Theodore Roosevelt once said, "It is the affair of every honest voter wherever born to see that no fraudulent voting is allowed."
If it's a real principle, rather than just partisan fear-mongering, it should apply to both parties equally. And that's your reality check.
Watching that very closely, and it's not over yet there, John. Thank you so much for bringing it to our attention.
Thanks, guys.
Thanks, John.
All right, the NFL facing a